Social media users appear to be deserting Elon Musk's platform X in their millions. Fed up with its hate speech and far-right political propaganda, users have found an alternative social media, Bluesky. How successful can it be, and is this the end of X? Hello and welcome to Roundtable. I'm Enda Brady. Now, since the takeover of X by Elon Musk in 2022, the social media site has seen a significant decline in users. Dissatisfied with his controversial changes to the site, users have been looking for alternatives like Bluesky. Can the network, founded by a Twitter co-founder, be the next X? And what's the future for social media?
In the wake of the US election, social media users left Elon Musk's platform X in droves, with 1 million joining rival network Bluesky, run by Twitter co-founder Jack Dorsey, in just one day. The X deserters were dissatisfied with Musk's leadership, the Trump political propaganda, misinformation, and offensive posts found on X. Since taking over the platform in 2022, Musk has relaxed content moderation, leading to a rise in hate speech from the far right. Its paid verification model blurs the line between credible sources and misinformation. Plus, algorithmic favoritism makes X feel less authentic and inclusive. Enter Bluesky, which promises a fresh start, built on decentralized social networking frameworks that give users control over algorithms and data, encouraging transparency and freedom. Users leaving the site include UK's left-leaning Guardian newspaper that branded X a toxic media platform with disturbing content used to shape political discourse. Musk hit back by posting that The Guardian is a dying publication and irrelevant. Many users describe Bluesky as similar to Twitter's early days: intimate, creative, and free from hate speech, a return to social networking as it's meant to be.
Something feels different about Bluesky. I've been on social media since I was 11, which is a very young age to start social media. And something about Bluesky feels very old, but fresh and new. And I feel like Bluesky feels like a safe space and a safe place.
However, Bluesky is still new. Its invite-only model limits user access, and questions remain about how it can grow without losing appeal. With competitors like Mastodon and Meta's Threads also competing for attention, the future of social media remains unpredictable.
Well, let's meet our guests. Joining me in the studio is Amanda Finch. She is CEO of the Chartered Institute of Information Security. Yousef Alhelou, political commentator and social media consultant. And we have Dominic O'Mara. He is the founder and CEO of the new social media app Supernova. You're all very welcome to Roundtable. Amanda, I'll come to you first. It's often said that social media has become kind of like a Wild West where anything goes. Tell me, is 2025 going to be the year we see a sheriff ride into town?
I don't know whether we're going to see somebody riding in on a charger and sorting everything out, but it does need to have more control around it. So what we're seeing is that different countries are taking different stances. So this week we've seen that Australia is looking to stop people under 16 going onto social media. And it looks as though they're going to implement fairly hefty fines on the platforms that don't comply with that. Within the UK, we had the online safety bill last year. And I think we'll see more off GEM and the other regulators are going to be looking at ways that they can regulate. Brazil, we saw them stop the use of X because they didn't feel that it was appropriate. So I think we will see different measures coming in. And I think it will vary on the country. So there'll be some winners and losers, always, as there is with these things. But there has to be some level of trust and control, because we've seen so much over the last year or so where people have been manipulating voting audiences.
Misinformation,
abuse, you know, you name it, criminal activity. It's a hotbed of terrible things, but there's also some very good things about social media as well.
Dominic, how badly needed is regulation?
I think that it's more needed than it should be. You know, I think there should be more self-governance within the social networks. And I think it's a shame that there hasn't been. I don't think that to ban things necessarily is the desired way that a legal system should go. But I understand it, you know, in view of the atrocities that you see, the unchecked toxicity that we see on these enormous social networks that have grown monstrously big, you know, without any form of real, you know, imposed governmental control, and haven't really been rewarded or penalised much for their own sense of self-governance. So how much is it needed? Well, sadly, it seems that it is. Should it be needed? No, I don't think it should. I think that social networks, and this is the stance we try to take, should have a sense of responsibility and opportunity. You know, it's a massive opportunity, this, of being able to offer a platform to people to connect with people and speak and to do some good, which is what we try and do. But yeah, that's I think, the opportunity is for more self-governance and giving people better care.
Yousef, tell me about your work. How important has social media been for you in terms of spreading the word and information about what's happening in Gaza, where you are from?
Well, first of all, my dissertation at Oxford University in 2013 was about the rise of citizen journalists in Palestine and their role in changing the perception of Palestine in the West. The role of citizen journalists in Palestine is very essential. Traditional media is no longer maintains monopoly on what's going on the ground. A lot of people found themselves obliged to report on what's going on. Anybody with a smartphone is a citizen journalist in Gaza nowadays. My Instagram account exploded. I've been reporting on the genocidal war, which is ongoing now for the second year. I used to have around 50,000. Now I've got over 1 million followers. I have at least 100 million views each month. I'm heavily restricted by Meta. Many of my posts are removed, and I'm being shadow banned. If I'm not shadow banned, I would have reached at least 10 million people. Now, Israel maintains a propaganda machine. It wants to prove its points. Palestinians have managed to weaken the Israeli narrative, and Palestinians are winning the online battle.
So social media for you has been a game changer in terms of your work.
It is indeed, yeah, of course. People nowadays, they no longer trust all of the traditional media corporations and outlets. So that's why people in the digital era, in the rise of the internet, rely on their social media platforms. For me, it's important. It has changed the world, and Gaza has changed me. So I rely heavily on social media, and that's why I established myself as a social media consultant.
Amanda, social media gets a bad rap a lot of the time and a bad reputation. Tell me, it does an awful lot of good, though, as well. It certainly has the power to do a lot of good. We should remember that.
Oh, definitely, definitely. And I think the thing is that in the hands of good people, it's a very, very powerful tool. It's an educator. It brings communities together. It makes you look at things that maybe you'd never think of looking at. So there are lots and lots of really good things about it. But coming back to Dominic's point, is that we don't need to keep the good guys good. It's that the good guys do want to do good things. Mm-hmm. The problem is, it's the bad guys that want to do the bad things. And where there's always things for good, you've got the criminals, you've got people that are trying to do, you know, coerce people, bully, all of those good sort of things. And that's the problem. But I can't see our lives without social media. But what I think will happen is that people will make choices about the platforms that they want to go onto. And we've seen that with X recently. If you talk to anybody under the age of about 30, I don't think they use Facebook anymore. So I think it'll be a moving feast as people become more sophisticated and as they follow their interests, things will come into fashion and things will come out of fashion. But yes, don't take it away, please.
Dominic, you've launched Supernova, so just tell us about where did you get the idea? What does it do?
Well, what it does is it makes good. It's a social network that gives back. So it does good. It makes good from social networking is what it does. And where I got the idea from was from seeing the rise of social media, just watching it grow and grow and grow unstoppably, and thinking what an enormous opportunity it would be to share the wealth in this world, you know, for example, and to share positive sentiment. And as time went by, I saw that this just wasn't happening, not a bit of it. My background's in advertising, and I know how that industry works, and I know the kind of figures that we're talking about. And it was kind of surprising to me that it took some time before the penny sort of dropped, and they sort of worked out, well, hang on a minute. We're the product. We're the reason that all this advertising is, advertising revenue is going on. So the thing is that I wanted to distribute that or find a way to do that. And so I created Supernova. And the mechanism there is that people collectively support charities and good causes that they want to help. You don't get to get paid to use Supernova. It's not that we share advertising revenue with the people that viewed the ad, because that amount of money is a tiny amount per person. But when it's all added together, it's an awful lot. You know, the industry generates around $200 billion worth of advertising money every year, just pure advertising money going through the hands of social networks. And what we do is we distribute that. So the way the mechanic works is you sign up, you support, you choose from one of 8 causal areas. You can only support one at a time, but you can change at any time. And then on the app, likes earn money for social networks. So we've turned on its head the narcissistic motivation of using social media and made it more of an altruistic one. And as you use the app, you earn karma. And once if you do so in a kind and positive way, and once your karma is complete, you can give a supernova, which is worth 10 times a normal like. So again, you get a rush from collecting karma and then giving it. You get an animated effect. It's gamey. You know, it's fun. We're not making a sort of like protest, dreary, complainy type app. It's a fun celebration kind of app to celebrate positivity.
So tell me, for people who would say social media is toxic and negative, what response have you had then? Are people interested?
That's entirely why they come to Supernova. We've done no marketing at all. Our growth is purely organic. We've been identified and described as the ethical alternative to Instagram. Not a phrase that we particularly used ourselves. It's just been what we're called. And if you wake up one morning and you think, gee, I wish there was an ethical alternative to Instagram, and Google that phrase, you will find Supernova because we're the top result. And that's what's brought people to us. So, yeah, it's people looking for, I guess, more positive, kinder alternatives. This is in no way to try and put the other guys, very much bigger guys, down, by the way. I'm just telling you how it's come about that people have started to use Supernova. I mean, we're still very, very small. We're at an evolutionary stage. But what we're doing, we found that people really love the concept, particularly younger people, Gen Z, ethically driven Gen Zs, particularly like the concept. So what we want to do now is develop the product more and then market it, scale it. And so we're doing what any of these guys have done here, which is we're raising the investment funding to do just that right now.
Yeah. Yousef, you've educated millions of people around the world with your use of social media about what Israel is doing in Gaza. How much pride do you take in being a prominent Palestinian with the amount of followers you have and the duty you feel to be doing what you're doing?
I'm obliged to raise awareness and share content in order to enlighten the world of what's happening. I know social media is going to stay. We are addicted to social media. But unfortunately, as the guests say, many people, they misuse social media in order to incite for violence. They share their crimes, like what the Israeli soldiers do. They brag, showing their crimes online. We are banned because there is awareness, but their accounts are also growing in numbers. There is also hypocrisy when it comes to deal with content creators. So I'm proud that I managed to reach millions around the world. I don't incite for violence. We use Palestinian narrative. We use facts in order to reach the audience. and weaken the Israeli propaganda machine that justifies anything happening in Gaza. So social media is a very powerful tool, and Palestinians are relying heavily on this tool.
Can I ask, how do you feel then when you look at social media and you see Israeli soldiers effectively documenting war crimes and posting them up on social media for likes when they have demolished your people's houses, taken your land, killed neighbors, friends, wiped out families?
It's like they are entitled for everything. They're not only stealing our land, they're stealing our cultural heritage, our cuisine, and no one is going to stop them. That's why they brag. They are arrogant. It makes me angry that the owners of those social media outlets, they allow such provocative behavior to go on, attacking civilians, destroying Palestinian houses, killing children, whereas us, the victims, are being heavily censored.
Amanda, to you, just the whole issue of content creation. I mean, people have made careers now out of content creation online. It's a huge growth industry. And I guess as much as regulation is coming, a lot of people won't want to see it for that very reason.
Can I just say one thing? I can't take a side on the war.
We understand
that. I have to stand back from that. Coming back to your question, is that, yes, people have done some amazing things. We had a lady that worked with us, and she's made a career for herself with TikTok videos and things like that, and she has 2 million followers, and she advertises products, and she's really good at it. And that is fabulous, because it is a new industry in many ways. That is a great thing to have. And I don't know if I've answered your question. You might need to re-ask me.
No, that's okay. Dominic, to you, I want to talk about Elon Musk, who is obviously a hugely powerful person in the world of social media. Mm-hmm. What's his game plan with X? Because people are leaving it in their droves for Bluesky.
They are, as you can see the logo behind me. Aren't they just? So 1 million a day recently is the number. What's his game? Well, I mean, that's a pretty good question. I mean, he bought it, I don't know if it was on a whim, but he bought it because he's incredibly rich, you know? I mean, I guess that's what you do when you're 230 billion. You go around buying things for 44 billion. He looks like he changed his mind because he tried to get out of that deal, but he had to go ahead and do it. And I guess, you know, when life brings you lemons, you make lemonade, don't you? So he's basically used it as a tool to garner the favour of the now incoming US president. I mean, I guess that was a little bit of a gamble. Trump might not have won, but he did. And he's now Trump's right-hand man. So whether by design or accident, it turns out to have been a tool to prosper his political influence, which, as an extremely rich man, you probably run out of things that you want for Christmas. International global political influence would probably be on his Santa's list. So it looks like he's got that. So maybe that was.
And what's your reading of what he's done with X since he's taken it over? Because you speak to people, speak to users, and so many people don't want anything to do with it anymore.
Well, so many don't, but so many do. So many want more to do with it. I mean, look, I don't use it myself. I mean, Supernova, by the way, is utterly apolitical. We have we don't have any politics at all on it. We remove anything that's sort of political or feisty because it's the cause of so many arguments. So we don't have that because we have a very positive outlook. We donate from our action fund.
So what do you do with negative comments then, or nastiness if you see it?
Well, if it's not, we have an appraisal system, right, for judging, you know, degrees of nastiness, if you will. And if something is, you know, defamatory, if it's if it's racist, sexist, any of the things that are quite patently, blatantly offensive, it's immediately removed. And the perpetrator will be banned forever on three, offences. And we don't have a long, drawn-out process for that with faceless emails or anything. We have human moderators that are highly trained and supported by AI for us, you know, to cope with things as we scale. But we remove them. They are gone. And that is why you will find no toxicity on Supernova. That is why you have complete and total user and brand safety.
So your app is a happy place?
Our app is a very, very happy home. Yeah, and you're all welcome to come and share it.
We will check it out. We will check it out. Yousef, I want to talk about the algorithms. You mentioned earlier on shadow banning. How does that affect your account then if you put up something that you want to give your narrative about what has happened in Gaza and the algorithm is hiding you or shadow banning you?
I agree that social media must be regulated because, as I said, some people misuse it and it's not easy to reach millions. You have to be smart. You have to be careful how to word the sentences, what kind of videos that you use. So to break the algorithm, from time to time, I have to share non-Palestinian content, not related to Palestine issue. And by the way, I created so many videos from the UK, from Europe, from across the Middle East about my travels. So part of my hobby to create content and influence people to visit those places. So I understand that social media, through relying on this tool, people can earn a living. As I said, it's to do with the type of content that interests people. Sometimes, of course, I receive threats from Meta, so I understand what kind of videos that, as they say, violated their community standards. At the end of the day, I'm worried that my account might be shut because at the end of the day, some people, not all people like you. Millions around the world, they support Palestine and our struggle for freedom. But other people, of course, they are anti-Palestinian.
Do you get complaints?
I will continue to influence people. No, I mean, there are 99% of the comments are positive. Sometimes at the beginning of this genocidal war, I received some threats from some Zionists because they are not happy from us reporting on their crimes in Gaza, Palestine. And at some point, one of the Zionists, he told me, why didn't you help us to release the hostages and to be anti-Hamas? I said, look, I'm an independent person. I'm not affiliated to any political party. This is my platform. If you are happy with the content, you are welcome. If you are not happy, don't follow me.
Simple as that. Amanda, I want to touch upon what you said earlier on about age restrictions. So it's clear this is coming. Australia's already voted for it. The UK's in favour. France is also in favour of making social media absolutely not part of life until you're 15. Do you think that's the correct age, 15, 16?
It's a really tricky one because some people are very mature at 15. Other people are not mature at, I don't know, 50 sometimes. So, where do you draw the line? I think the thing is that it's access to the content. And I think this is where we're coming back to people being able to access content where they're not being cyberbullied. You know, you get a lot of this sort of sexual coercion that goes on. So 16 is obviously still very, very young to let people have free rein. So I think it's probably a graduated scale of where people should be able to go. But it's also coming back to actually taking very seriously people that are doing things that are deeply unpleasant and bringing them to book in the same way as they would be in real life. Mm. So it's difficult. I put a lot of responsibility back with the platform providers. They should be looking at that sort of content. I can't imagine anybody of any age should be really seeing things that are either illegal, immoral, whatever you call immoral.
Damaging and disturbing.
Damaging, yes. Yeah. I mean, why do you need to have a site that shows you how to commit suicide? Mm-hmm. You know, that. What good is that going to be doing to society?
Dominic, your view, Dominic, on the age restrictions, they're clearly coming in this country as well, mm-hmm. in the UK, mm. following on from the Australian Prime Minister's idea. We've had some very high-profile tragic cases in the United Kingdom of young people losing their lives off the back of cyberbullying, intimidation, material they've seen. Do you think 2025 will be the year when the UK cracks down on age restrictions?
I hope it's the year they crack down on toxicity on social media, and whether that's got to do with age restriction or not is a different debate. I take the view that 16 is the right age. That's the age that we have on Supernova as the minimum age, the right minimum age, I should say. We don't allow anyone younger than that on the platform. You know, we just automatically self-governed ourselves into thinking that that is the right sort of thing to do. We don't feel that it's useful or beneficial versus the alternatives you could do with your mind and your time prior to that age. We think that's early enough. You know, it's a long enough, you know, time you're going to be over 16. So in those years up to 16, do something else. Get up and go out. You know, don't sit there looking at your screen. That's the view that we take. Do we need legislation to do that? Apparently. Apparently so. We don't. Our app, Supernova does not. We're doing it voluntarily. But it looks like the industry requires that shove in the right direction. So I think it's a good thing.
But you've got a good heart.
Yes,
and that's the thing, is that I do cybersecurity, so I see the bad guys.
Yes.
The bad guys always use whatever platforms they can.
Sure.
And you don't need regulating.
No, I don't need regulating. But you know, what we do need, though, is as we scale, what would be nice, I mean, I don't think we're going to get it, is some support. You know, I think if governments want to do something, they could give grants to little startups that are trying to start something good. That'd be great.
Amanda, Dominic and Yousef, it's a story we will all follow throughout 2025, no doubt. Remember, you can see more discussion and debate on our YouTube channel. Just search for Roundtable, TRT World. But for now, from me, Enda Brady, and all of the team here, goodbye and thank you for watching.